So I'm going to present the new results on solar neutrino that has been published in the last few months from the Borexin experiment. So in my talk, I will start from a brief summary, a historical summary about the solar neutrino study. Then I will present the Borexino project, which is aimed at high-precision solar neutrino spectroscopy. In 2017, we have presented the new updated result with the new phase 2 data on all the solar neutrino species, PP, beryllium 7, PAP, CNO, and boron 8 neutrinos. And also we have released a new limit on the neutrino magnetic moment. At the end, I will present the future perspectives. Now, the sun luminosity is mostly supported by the PP chain, and only a small amount is produced through the CNO cycle. And as you can see in the PP chain, there are emitted several neutrino species, the PP neutrinos, which are emitted in the very first reaction, the PAP, this is a very rare branch, the beryllium 7 and boron 8 neutrinos. The CNO cycle instead emits three main components, which are the nitrogen 13, oxygen 15, and fluorine 17 neutrinos. Now, here in this plot are shown the expected fluxes according to the most recent solar model by Vignoles et al. As you can see, the beryllium 7 and PP neutrinos show monochromatic lines because they are emitted in the two-body reaction, while the PP neutrinos have a broad spectrum with an endpoint around 420 keV. These are the CNO neutrinos, whose endpoint is around a few MeV, as you can see, and the boron 8 neutrino, whose endpoint is around 17 MeV. The original motivation of the first experiment on solar neutrino was to test the standard solar models. But starting from the 70s, the neutrino fluxes were successfully detected, but all the experiments put in evidence a problem in the sense that the measured fluxes came out to be smaller by a factor 2-3 with respect to expectation according to the solar models. So this discrepancy was known as the solar neutrino problems, and in principle different possible explanations were advanced, some error in the experiment, but this was rejected by calibrating with neutrino sources, for example the Galex and Sajer experiment, some possible nuclear physics solution, for example a resonance in the helium 3 praseodymium channel. This was rejected by Luna measurement performed at the Gran Sasso. This possibility, it was excluded, but as it was already pointed out by Pontecorvo, if neutrino are massive, they could oscillate. So they could change their flavor composition moving from the source to the detector. This possibility, as now we know, was the correct one. It was pointed out by the SNO experiment in Canada. The trick adopted by the SNO collaboration was to study among the different channels, also this one, which is supported by neutral current interaction. In this case, the cross-section is the same for all the neutrino species, and in fact, the flux that they measured was consistent to what is expected according to the models. So what we have learned is that the signal depends on the detection reaction on the channel that you decide to adopt, and of course on the neutrino flavor composition at the detection site. What now we know is that the solar neutrino not only do oscillate in the vacuum, but there is also an enhanced conversion in the sun for multi-MeV neutrinos in this energy region because of the scattering process with the electron MSLW effect. So according to the MSW large mixing angle paradigm, what we expect is to observe a survival probability like the one represented here. And you see that moving from high to low energy, we expect to observe a typical upturn in the survival probability. Now that we have understood the reason for the solar neutrino problem, we need still to perform a precision spectroscopy for two main reasons. The first one is for particle physics reasons, because we need to improve the knowledge of the mixing parameters. And in particular, you can see that this energy region is very sensitive to the delta M square value, and in this region, the data are missing. And another region of interest is that in this energy region, several different models based on non-standard neutrino interaction to possible mixing with lateral neutrino to predict a different behavior of the survival probability. So it is very important to make precision measurement. Another reason of interest is the well-known metallicity puzzle, Evette was born in 2009 when Asplund and Grevesse published new value for the metal content of the sun based on improved models, but with these values the solar model are no more able to reproduce pretty well the sun spirit profile in the outer layers of the sun and to reproduce heliosismological data. And the neutrinos are very sensitive to the metal content of the sun. As you can see, there are differences larger than 9% in beryllium 7 flux, of 18% in the boronate, and up to, let's say, 40% in the CNO neutrino fluxes. These are very sensitive to the metal content of the sun. So to perform precise measurement is really important also to understand these problems. Here you can see in this slide the wide energy range, which is accessible to Borexino, whose goal is to measure in real time the single component of the solar neutrino spectrum. Here it is shown the layout of the detector, and it is based on the principle of degraded shielding, in a sense that the innermost is the shell, the highest is its radio purity. The neutrinos are detected through the scattering of electrons, and let me remind that even in presence of monochromatic line, what we observe it is a broad spectrum having a Compton-like shape, let's say, like this one. So, the point is, sorry, I forgot one thing. So since what we detect is a scintillation light, this is of course gives a high light yield and so a good sensitivity also at low energies, but unfortunately the scintillation is isotropical and so we cannot point the direction of the sun. For this reason we are able to detect the solar neutrino only in presence of very, very small backgrounds. And the collaboration spent 15 years to recognize the best experimental techniques in order to achieve the proper background. And this effort was really successful because when in 2007 we switched off our detector, we observed that, for example, the uranium and thorium contamination were two orders of magnitude better with respect to design goal. And we had, starting from 2007 up to 2010, the first phase one data taking, which was already very successful for the first measurement of the beryllium 7 and PAP neutrinos, and also we observe other species, rare processes, and we also detect the signal of geoneutrinos. And I remind you the talk on Friday by a colleague of mine, Oleg Smirnov, which speaks about the geoneutrinos. Then in 2010 we started new purification, which we are again successful, especially in reducing the krypton 85 and led to the 10 contamination of the scintillator. And so from 2012 we started a phase 2 data taking, which is going to be finished with the end of this year. This new phase 2 data take the advantage of larger exposure, background reduction, and also a more accurate description of the detection response. Here are reported all the, our phase 2 results, and all these results have been released this year. In particular, in July, we released the first simultaneous spectroscopy of PP beryllium 7 and POP solar neutrino. In September, so just 1 month ago, we released a new updated result on boronate and new upper limit on neutrino magnetic moment. I will present now all these results. Let me speak about the signal and backgrounds in Borexino. Here on this slide, I reported the simulation for all the expected signals and background. This in red, these are the recorded energy spectrum for PP neutrinos, this is beryllium 7, and this is CNO, and this is PAP, and all the main component of the background. On the right, instead, there are the real data, in black without any cut, in blue applying the muon cut, that means we reject all the events that triggered the outer detector, or that has been recognized as muon by making a pulse-shaped analysis of the signal in the inner detector. But you see that the highest rejection of the background is achieved by applying the fiducial volume cut. And the reason is clear, because we use all the external layers of the scintillator as a passive shield against the external gamma rays. And so you recognize the main feature of our spectrum. This is the carbon 14. This peak is polonium 210, which is an alpha emitter, which is, belongs to which is a daughter of lead 210. But you can clearly see by eye the compound like judge due to beryllium 7 neutrinos, so you can appreciate how clean is our detector. And another background, which you can see here, is the carbon 11, but we have exploited some tricks to remove this contamination. Carbon 11 is produced, this is cosmogenic, it's produced by cosmogenic muon interacting with carbon 12, But since usually you have the signal due to the muon when a neutron is emitted in association, and also carbon 11, you can recognize this triple coincidence, and so we have built up a likelihood function, but a certain event is carbon 11, putting together the information about the distance in space and time respect to the muon track, the distance for the neutron, and so, and by using this likelihood function, we are able to reject 92% of the carbon 11, keeping an exposure of 64%. But since the carbon 11 is also a beta plus emitter, its signal is different respect to a recoiled electron because it forms for a few nanosecond ortho positronion when it annihilates. So the time and let's say this spatial distribution of the released energy deposit and light is different respect to recoiled electrons, and so we build up a likelihood function that also is useful to further reject the carbon 11, and so you can appreciate this result in the difference between the red and the green curve. This region is important because it is the one relevant, for example, for PAP neutrinos. And so, of course, if one wants to perform simultaneous spectroscopy of PP beryllium 7 and PAP neutrino, one has to perform a spectral fit over a quite wide energy range for a few hundred of kV to few MeV. And so one has to deal with the presence of several residual backgrounds that makes it complex to extract the neutrino signal from the data. So what we have done, the method has been to maximize binned likelihood through a multivariate approach. So we had in the likelihood we have contemporary included the energy spectrum before and after the carbon 11 subtraction, the pulse shape distribution variable to further reject carbon 11, and the radial distribution of event, which is particularly useful to disentangle the external background. We have also checked the possible systematical effect in several ways. We have performed the fit in energy condition, different energy ranges, variables. We have used four different energy estimators, and also we have changed the binning. We have developed a tool Monte Carlo to build up a Monte Carlo data set with the same exposure as in the data, so we have simulated thousands of possible experiments. We have fit this data with the same PDF used for the real data, and we have checked in such a way for bias, sensitivity, and correlation. Then we have performed an energy fit by using a Monte Carlo and analytical approach. So this is a very robust checks for every possible systematic effect and every inconsistency. Let me just say another things that unfortunately, since the bismuth-210 background, which is here highlighted in green, the CNO and PAP spectra are very similar. What we have done has been during this analysis to constrain the CNO neutrino rate to the high metallicity or low metallicity expectation. And you can see what these are the values according to the solar models. And let me say that this is indeed is all important for the PAP neutrino, while the beryllium 7 and PP neutrinos are not affected by this uncertainty. So this is the example of a multivariate fit. This is the possible output, and we have fitted the contemporary all this distribution. This is, for example, it is a Monte Carlo fit of a spectrum after the carbon 11 subtraction, and as you can see, over the old energy range, the residuals are flat and very small. Okay, so in this slide, I summarize all the recent results of this paper, and I compare this is the reference, if you're interested to. I compare all this result with the one that has been obtained by Borexino using this one data, and you can see that we have been able to achieve a very sizable reduction of the background. The present exposure is 252 tons per year. In particular, let me underline that the beryllium 7 precision that now we have achieved is of only 2.7%, while the one of the theoretical fluxes from the solar model is of 7%. This 70% is more in the solar model is mostly due to the uncertainty in the helium 3 plus helium 4 cross section. So solar model need further input from nuclear astrophysics to improve these numbers. But the very good precision that we have been able to achieve allowed us, for example, to observe the seasonal modulation of the Beryllium 7 Sirion, because of course the distance between the Earth and the Sun is changing, and so we observe this modulation of the signal. If we fit this time behavior, we got values for the eccentricity, for the period and for the phase, which is perfectly consistent to what we expect. And so we can say that we have measured the astronomic years by using the solar neutrinos. This is the result for the PEP neutrinos. As I also for we improved the precision on this number, but now we are able to achieve an evidence at 5 sigma. This is the likelihood profile, fixing the CNO content to high metallicity and low metallicity values. And as you can see, in both cases, the evidence is still above 5 sigma. But as you can see here in this slide, if we choose the event which are in the innermost part of the detector, the 73 innermost tone, what we can see is clearly recognized the Compton-like edge to the PEP neutrinos recoil. Borexinet is the only experiment in the world having the sensitivity to observe this spectrum. So, what about the CNO? Okay, as I told you in the introduction, it's very important to measure this component of the flux. On the basis of the present analysis, we've been able only to release an upper limit, which is this one. To get this upper limit, we have fixed the PEP neutrino flux ratio to what is expected according to the solar models. Let me say that in any case, the Borexino collaboration is still pushing the effort toward a possible eventual measurement of CNO, so we are still working. Then another important result is that by using the neutrino fluxes, we can prove the solar fusion because it holds this relation that has been obtained by Bacol in 2003. So if you take the ratio between this flux component, you can constrain the helium 3 plus helium 4 and helium 3 plus helium 4 rays ratio. And the reason for this relation is clear because you can see that the helium 3 plus helium 3 reaction is here at the bifurcation of the PP1 termination. This is a neutrinosless branch, while the helium 3 plus helium 4 cross-section, therefore rays, it influences the branches which gives neutrino. So if we take, we compute this ratio on the basis of our data, we get 0.18. According to high metallicity models, we expect 0.18, so the same value, while the low metallicity predicted lower value, 0.16. Still, the errors are large, so we cannot be conclusive, but we can say that we prefer the high metallicity models. And this is a sort of coherent indication which is emerging from our data. As I told you in the introduction, it is particularly important to explore the transition region, especially because the SOAR experiment in 2011 point out that instead of observing an upturn, as it is expected, they observe a sort of downturn. This Super K experiment, which is here put in evidence in green, instead observes something which was compatible to the upturn. Now, Borexino released the first result about boron 8 neutrino, whose spectrum extends over this energy range in 2010. But now, if we put together the statistics of phase 1 and phase 2, we get 2000 days at all, 2100 more or less. And in this new analysis that we have released 1 month ago, we have extended the fiducial mass to the whole fiducial volume, 300 tons. Therefore, the total exposure of these present results is more or less a factor of 0.12, sorry, factor 12 larger respect to the previous results. Now, in order to study the behavior as a function of the energies, we have divided our event sample into energy range, a low energy and a high energy sample, which more or less correspond to average neutrino energies of 7.9 and 9.9 respectively. For making this analysis, we have followed different cuts respect to the one of the PEP and PEP neutrinos because we are taking into account an energy range which is more or less complementary respect to the one of the other analysis above 3 MeV in terms of recoiled electrons energies. And so we applied a strong muon cut after each, sorry, a strong time cut after each muon because there are several cosmogenic nuclei that could be dangerous for this analysis. And in the high energy range, after this cut, but okay, I don't want to go in detail, but in any case, they are listed here. After this cut, the most important background in the high energy portion of the spectrum are the thermal gamma from NGAM reaction, while in the low energy part of the spectrum, we have still this external gamma and thallium 208. But this contamination can be quantified quite precisely by means of the BIPO-212 coincidence, because you can see bismuth-214 can decay into thallium-208, which is this dangerous background. But in 64% of branches, it gives polonium-210, which has a fast decay. So we observe a fast coincidence, which can be clearly recognized in our data sample. And so this has been used to quantify precisely the thallium-208 contamination in the scintillator bulk. But in order to disentangle the boronate signal from all these external gamma, especially the one induced by N-gamma reaction, we have performed the log likelihood fit of the radial distribution. And here I quoted all the signals and backgrounds according to this fit. Here it is reported our results. And as you can see, we improved by a factor 2 the precision of this number. We are compatible to what is expected according to solar models, but let me say that indeed, again, if here in this slide I summarize over all our measurements, but if we focus on the boronate result, you can see that again we are more closer to the expectation according to the high metallicity respect to the low metallicity models. And so again, even if of course the errors are still large, we are pointing this direction. Another way to see the same is, for example, to plot the observed signal, the ratio between the observed signal respect to expectation for the beryllium-7 and for boronate fluxes. This region is the one hallowed at 3 sigma, the blue one, by all the existing experiments on solar neutrino plus Kamland. And these two regions in pink and green, let's say, are the expectation. This is the error bars at 1 sigma according to high metallicity and low metallicity models. So you can see that data are closer to high metallicity, but unfortunately it is difficult. Okay, we can say that experimental data now are quite precise. The point is that the errors are as large, okay, you see, the errors in the models are very large. And these on the boronate prediction are mostly due to knowledge of the opacity, of the diffusion coefficient, and also on some nuclear physics input, like the proton plus beryllium-7 cross-section and heliotrin plus helium-4. So the input of the solar model need to be improved in order to be more conclusive. It is the survival probability as measured by Borexino. When you plot the survival probability, you have to take the ratio between what you measured and sense what you expect. So this in pink is in both this plot is the expectation according to MSW, large mixing angle paradigm. And instead, these are our data if we divide by the expectation according to the high metallicity or low metallicity models. And again, you can see that our results are in fair agreement with high metallicity and not so bad good agreement with low metallicity. So this is, let me say, it's a sort of complete overview. This is a reported the p-values, and you can see that even if you cannot say, okay, the final word, but this is an indication. And just okay, to illustrate the good work that we have done, this is the knowledge of the survival probability before Borexino, and this is Borexino alone. So you see how fairly we have improved the knowledge of the survival probability. Just let me remind these results. We have also released a new upper limit on the neutrino magnetic moment. Since the neutrino are mass different than zero, in a simple extension of the solar models, they could acquire a magnetic moment different than zero. In the case of a magnetic moment different than zero, also the cross-section change because there is a further terms. It is here illustrated. And because of these further terms in the cross-section, you expect a different behavior of the recoiled electron spectrum. So we have obtained a new limit studying the K-square profile of our fit result as a function of this hypothetical electromagnetic contribution, and we got this upper limit, which is the best limit among the solar and reactor experiments. So let me come to the conclusion. With the new phase 2 data, Borexin has entered in the year of precision spectroscopy, and thanks to its exceptional radio purity, has gone well beyond its original goals. And in the newest result, we have presented a first simultaneous extraction of PAP and beryllium-7 neutrino flux. In particular, notably, the beryllium-7 precision is only 2.7%, while the theoretical uncertainty is 7%. We have obtained a new determination of the boronate neutrino flux with a precision of 55%, 5 sigma evidence for the PAP neutrino signal, and we can say that there are hints from Borexino toward high metallicity that are coming from the beryllium-7 and boronate neutrino measurement. We have determined for the first time the ratio between the helium-3 plus helium-3 and helium-3 plus helium-3 reaction in the Sun, and the new limit on the neutrino magnetic moment. Now we can say that we have really achieved a good thermal stabilization of the detector. The polonium content is decayed, so we are going on with the effort toward the CNO, but in spring 2019 we will start the SOX project with the introduction of the anti-neutrino source below the detector in order to exploit the possible oscillation into sterile neutrinos. Thank you, that's all.
So, thank you very much, Sam.